is a novel. It's Le Bruit des Échelles. It is two women meet, and there's an older lady. She's a kind of in a kind of wise woman type of figure, and she meets a young woman who is buried. She has inside her a very deep buried grief. She lost her father, but not just because of that, because of, I think of her as a kind of contemporary, superfluous person, somebody who has no sense of any purpose. And she's living with a man who is kind of, not abusing her, but kind of manipulating her. And she knows it's happening, but she hasn't got the energy to say, stop, you know, let's change this. So she's drinking heavily, she takes drugs, she drinks, and the old lady says to her, if you stop this, I will tell you the story of my life. And the young woman does so because she doesn't even know why she's doing that, but she does so she can hear the old lady's story. And she thinks she's going to use the story as part of an art project that she and her boyfriend are working on. But really, of course, the whole thing is that she needs to hear the story so she can tell her story, and the old lady needs to tell hers. So it's a kind of cycle that eventually starts as a circle, so they tell each other. And that was really, in a sense, the story was a kind of pretext for what I really wanted to talk about. And this was written before Donald Trump became president, but I want to make that really clear, that I was desperate about American history. When you go to America, I mean, I'm not one of these Europeans who hates America now just because, you know, they've done some bad things politically. Britain's done some bad things politically too, and I don't hate Britain, so the same thing. But I just was in despair because the Americans I meet don't know their history, don't know any history, or they only know certain history. And I remember talking about Fred Hampton, and for me that was a very important event, Fred Hampton's murder in 1969 by the FBI and the CIA and the Chicago Police Department. And I talked about this, and people said, who is Fred Hampton? And I said, well, you know, it's a Black Panther. Oh, Black Panther terrorists. You're like, terrorists? Black, they were defending themselves. So you get into this argument, and you want to say, okay, can I write a book that will tell that history, that alternative history? And I got in touch with some people who were in the Weather Underground, the movement in the 70s, and I started corresponding with David Gilbert, who's a prisoner still in New York State. And then I realized that, in fact, a novel isn't a history, it's a novel, it's a story. So, of course, that was happening at the same time as the two women were becoming real people for me. And so they kind of took over the novel, and the novel was really about their relationship. So in a way, I'd planned a much bigger book with much more history in it, because I felt people needed to know that. But in the end, it became a story about these two women and their relationship, and the act of storytelling and the act of listening. And for me, in the end, the important thing was not the story necessarily, the story we tell to someone else or we tell to ourselves, but when we listen to others. And if you look at the United States now, the main problem that's in the United States is no one is listening to anyone else. They're just all shouting their idea, and left and right, not just the right. And we need to stop and start listening to each other. And so that was kind of, in a sense, the kind of theme that emerged during the making of the book. I don't really know what a book is about until I've finished it, and then I rewrite it to say, oh, that's what it's really about, you know. So there's a plot, but the plot, you know, the plot is a plot. But the ideas were more, in a sense, more important for me. For me, entertainment, diversion, I mean, these kinds of things that, you know, the media, the mass media do, are really distractions from the real narratives of our lives, are the political narratives that are really happening. You know, you watch TV in America, you watch Fox News, say, for one extreme, and you hear a very persuasive story, which is completely false, completely false. And you watch Rachel Maddow, and you see something, someone trying to find the truth at least, you know, trying. And you say, how can these two narratives coexist in the same country? And how can someone really believe these lies, you know? And I'm not just talking about the United States, I'm talking about everywhere in a way, but it's become so obvious now in the US. And for me, I could feel America growing in that direction. for years before the Trump situation happened. So that's, again, you know, that's what I wanted to explore. And I could see that every other country, most other countries have the same problem of this, you know, constant diversion, constant amusement and entertainment to keep people from thinking about what really matters. But America was the most extreme version of this. You know, everything is a kind of, you know, diversion. And, you know, here now you get into a train and every single person in the train is looking like this at a machine. You walk along the street, they're looking like this at a machine, they walk into you, they don't even say sorry, they keep on going, they're playing some stupid game on the machine, or they're checking, you know, what's happened to the latest celebrity. And I think, what's happening here? What's happening to our society? We've become infantile. We can't, you know, it's like a child. When my kids were in their cot, sleeping, you know, lying before they slept, we would give them the little mobiles to play with, and they would kind of, you know, and that's why, look at growing up, people doing now. You know, like, why? why? Are we afraid to think about what's going on? Maybe we are. Maybe we're just thinking it's gone so far now, environment-wise, for example. Maybe we can't fix it and we're scared, so we just think, oh, let's look the other way. And that's how we got to the stage we are in American politics. So people ignored the history, they ignored what was going on, they didn't want to think about it, and instead they watched, I mean, I call it Disneyfication. Everything turned into Walt Disney. Why? Because it was the end of the millennium, so the main reason. I didn't want to get into millennial stuff, I didn't want to get into 9/11. If it had been set after 9/11, that would be a completely different kind of question. And you know, everyone was right about 9/11, I just didn't want to do that. And also because 9/11 provided for a lot of people a kind of barrier to the history before. In American history, it seems to have started again with 9/11, so you could ignore the 70s and the 60s. But something I found really interesting was, I was writing to this guy who's in prison and was an activist, and is still an activist from prison, and I said, how do you feel about the movement, the collapse of the movement in the, you know, when Reagan came and he was arrested, etc. And he said, the movement didn't collapse. The movement never collapses, the movement continues, always, you know? There's always resistance. So it takes different forms at different times. And I thought about that, because I thought, this is a personal thing for me, I kind of dropped out of what I'd call mainstream politics, like being a member of the party and things like that, because I lost faith, I lost hope. When the backlash in the 80s was so severe, I just thought, this isn't worth fighting anymore. And I want to fight for the environment instead. In the late 70s, I became more involved with the environment, and I did environmental activism and stuff like that. And then I saw people doing really stupid things like animal rights, people that were friends of mine, releasing animals into the wild and stuff like that. I said, why are you doing this? It's stupid. You know, they would do things like they would raid a mink farm and then release all the mink, which, you know, they would then go and kill all the rare fish in the rivers. You know, there's no natural predator of mink in the UK. So they would release them and they would be there. And I agree with their principles, but not their methods. And that's been the story of my life, in fact. I've agreed with lots of people in principle, but when they start doing something, they usually mess it up. When I came back to live in Scotland in the 1990s, there was a very, you know, burgeoning kind of Scottish scene, as it were. And I was quite interested, people like Alan Warner and A.L. Kennedy and James Kelman and these guys who were doing something really interesting, Alistair Gray. Now I don't pay much attention to what's happening in Scotland. I although I'm Scottish born and I live in Scotland, I was away for a long time. I wasn't part of the nationalist independence thing. I thought that was a distraction again. And, you know, we should all be working together for social justice for all, not for one little part of the country. You know, so I'm disinclined to kind of nationalism, you know. And I think some of the writers that I used to find interesting, not all by any means, but some of the people who I found interesting when I came back here have moved into a kind of sentimental nationalist kind of mentality. And I find that uninteresting, if not just obnoxious sometimes, but I certainly don't find it very interesting. And I'm drawn to writing from Asia and Africa and Australia. And of course, the other thing is I teach American literature. And so I keep up with what's happening in America all the time, of course. I have to. And for me right now, the really exciting thing that's happening in America is some of the black writers like Terence Hayes, fantastic poet. I mean, you know, for me, he's like the major find. His new book, it's called American Sonnets for My Past and Future Assassin. It's a response to the murders on the street of black kids by cops. It's a response to Trump and all those things. So it's very topical, and at the same time, it's also historically and profound, because what he's trying to say is, look, as a black writer, I would like to say my tradition begins with Langston Hughes and people like that, and you know, ignore the white tradition because that was racist, and but I can't, because I've learned so much from that tradition, and I need to incorporate it in some meaningful way into my work. And I felt that too with regard to England, because I moved to England when I was 10. My favorite writers are all English, you know, from rather than Scottish, as it were. Most of them are American or English. So part of the reason I wrote the book also was that kind of thing of what stories we believe, you know, what stories we carry with us, how the stories we use to limit ourselves. I mean, the old lady, she lived in a time when to be a lesbian was to be a kind of weirdo, a freak, you know, and she had to learn that loving another woman was just a normal thing to do. And, you know, for her, she was, inside her, she was carrying all kinds of stuff that she'd learned. But she didn't recognize from very early on that it was women that she was drawn to, right from her friendship with the florist in the early days. And then she's passing on to the young women a sense that you can create a sense of self-determination from the narratives that you tell. So that's what I hope for literature. You see that people say, oh, why are you so interested in literature when you really care about politics? I hope that literature will contribute in some way by having creating narratives that make people say, okay, you know, this is something to think about.